so you don't have to sit in your mapon kivua, as we say it. You know, you don't have to sit in your fixed place. You can actually, you know, move back. You don't have to feel there. She's Sherry. Sherry's already figured that.
She just went back. We'll see.
Then I'm going to introduce Harvey, who is going to introduce in turn our speaker for this evening. I just simply want to say personally how privileged I think we all are to be here this evening and in the presence of really one of the movers and shakers and shapers of Judaism, not only on these shores, but in Eretz Israel, and for that matter, expanding all over the world. So this is really a wonderful opportunity we have. And with that said, I'm going to ask Harvey, our host, if he would introduce Rabbi Riskin.
Good evening, everyone. I know you can hear me. I don't need a microphone. Avi, I got you covered. I've had the pleasure of knowing Rabbi Riskin for 4 decades. I know he doesn't look that old. I met, but we've known one another for 4 decades, from his days in Midtown Manhattan, to when he decided he would make Aliyah, which made me jealous, to the successful settlement in Nefrat, to all the wonderful things he's done, going back to his fights for Soviet Jewry. The list goes on and on. I hope you read his bio. I hope you buy his book. When you listen to him tonight, what you will hear when he speaks is his passion for Zionism, his passion for Judaism. It comes out every time I speak with him. So I hope you enjoy the interview with that, because you don't want to hear me, Rabbi Shlomo Riskin.
Thank you very much, Harvey. It's always very good coming someplace where you don't only know the one who gave the introduction, but I was privileged to know his parents, Aleihem HaShalom. Very, very special. Very special people. And relationship is a multi-generational one. And we certainly agree about more things than we disagree about, which is always good as well. Rabbi Siegel, thank you for your kind words. Moray and Abotai, members of the congregation, I urge people in the back to come closer. Come, it's all right. No, come, please. Come on. There are many, many things I could talk about, and I think I was willed that I would speak about reform and conservative in Israel. I'll make it a little bit more of a general topic, and I'll talk about my relationship with the chief rabbi in Israel. And then I can sit down and go home. Because there's not much of a relationship with the body.
Okay.
Just a few words of introduction. You know, all the Yiddish speakers used to say, before I begin speaking, let me say a few words. So just a few words of introduction. Many, many years ago in Lincoln Square Synagogue, a gentleman came over to me at the end of davening, and he said to me, "You know, Rabbi Riskin, I didn't ask you, and I'm not sure what you would have said, but I had a granddaughter who was being bat mitzvahed in the Reform Temple in Manhattan. And I wasn't sure that I should attend services or not attend services. But I decided not to ask you, and I decided to come. And I learned many interesting things. So I smiled and I said to him, first of all, that's tough. And second of all, what was the most interesting thing you learned? And he said to me, I learned that a rabbi can give a sermon for 10 minutes. Why is it that you always give your sermons for at least 20, 25 minutes? And I had to think very quickly. I said to him, I'll tell you. Rabbis are notoriously known for making up their sermons on the way to the synagogue. The Reform rabbi takes his car. I had a walk, and I meet people along the way, 20, 25. Now you're all laughing, but I think now you will stop laughing. Because I want you to know that it took me at least 15 hours on planes to get here to Canada. So that I had a lot of time to decide what I was going to say to you this evening. But I'm not going to speak at length. And I do hope that you will ask questions, and you can ask me whatever you want to ask me, actually. I'll just say a few words about my relationship with the chief rabbi. And in both of these areas, everything that happened was widely publicized. First of all, in terms of Reform and conservative rabbis and Jews, that was the first kind of argument that we had publicly. And the second, conversion, which is something very close to my heart, as I will explain to you as we continue together to learn a little bit more. First, let me tell you about something which I'm sure you've read about in the press as well. There's a very grave rift between Israeli Jewry and American Jewry in terms of the place of conservative Israel. And let me try to explain. Prime Minister Netanyahu had come to an understanding through the Jewish Agency that there would be a separate place at the Kotel, at the Western Wall, where there could be egalitarian prayer services for conservative and Reform Jews. And then he took back the permission. Actually, in practice, I think it's still going on, those egalitarian services at Robinson's Arch. And I have every reason to believe it will continue. But when the agreement was made, it would have been official services. And this way, it's ad hoc services, but not necessarily official. And this caused the conservative and Reform to be very much upset, as you can understand. Prime Minister Netanyahu felt he had no choice, because the political situation in Israel is such that the Haredim, or the ultra-Orthodox, have a very important place on his coalition government. And they played hardball. They said they would leave the coalition and the government would for the pond. If they had official services that were egalitarian, and therefore he reneged on the deal. There was a great deal of debate, certainly in the Jewish agency, within Israel itself as well. Basically, and unfortunately, the chief rabbis expressed themselves in a very bad way. They called conservative and reform Gentiles, non-Jews. Really, I'm afraid, out of a certain primitivism and a certain ignorance. But that's what he said. I'm a very proud Orthodox rabbi, and I'm the rabbi of a municipality called the Frat, which has today some 14,000 people and 28 synagogues in 9 hills. And as an Orthodox rabbi, I was asked to comment on what the conservative, what the chief rabbis had said. And I said, I don't understand. The conservative and reform rabbis are certainly Jews. And in the eyes of God, they may be better Jews than I am. Perhaps, most importantly, they are my partners. And this caused, again, a great deal of controversy in Israel. And it was quoted widely. That Rabbi Riskin calls Orthodox, calls conservative and reform his partners. And that's what they are. Now, to make my point as clear and as honest as I can, I don't agree with many of the things that conservative and reform have as tenets of their belief. I would not pray in an egalitarian minyan, because I believe, Orthodoxy believes, that men and women must sit separately.
We're having trouble hearing you.
Oh.
The sound is not very good. It's very like unequal.
So maybe it's better now. I believe very profoundly that the conservative and reform rabbis are my partners and not my enemies. Even though I may disagree with many issues. I think that disagreeing is very helpful. Indeed, the Talmud, which is the most important literature next to the Bible within Jewish life, 60 tomes, the Talmud, that deal with every issue that anyone can think of. There is nothing human alien to the thoughts of the rabbis of the Talmud. It is the most pluralistic literature I've ever seen. There are rabbinical arguments about every single issue under discussion. And despite the arguments, or probably because of the arguments, and the honesty of the arguments, despite their disagreements, they respect each other deeply and continue to learn from each other, even while they disagree with each other. The one who says this most clearly is Rabbi Isaac HaKoenko. And he says it very succinctly. It's written in the Talmud, Talmidei Chachamim Mardim Shalom Ba'olam, which literally means scholars of Torah add to the peace in the world. Marbim Shalom Ba'olam literally would mean bring many explanations of peace to the world. Marbim is a plural noun. So Rav Kook says as follows. Shalom is unity. Peace is unity. But not and never unanimity. Peace does not mean that everyone under the rubric of peace thinks the same way. Peace is what emerges when there are many different opinions and often opposing opinions. And the opinions are brought together and lived together, sometimes in different communities, but most often in the same communities, and sometimes even in the same Talmudic academy. And the result is the sum total of all of these different. One of the most beautiful explanations of dissent within the Talmud. Eilu ve'eilu divrei Elokim chayim. These and those are the words of the living God. That there isn't only one absolute truth. Because the real truth is that there are many truths. Let me give you a strange example, but I'm sure you'll understand what I mean. When I was much younger, I spent much of my time in youth seminars, teaching young people without real Jewish backgrounds about Judaism. We ran Shabbatonim on Sabbath, Chagonim on the holidays. There was one young woman, I at that time was maybe 20, 21. And there was one young woman who was 14. She said she had a problem. She said there are many Jews in New York, and there were at that time many such Jews, who kept kosher in the house, but outside of the house, if they had eaten in the restaurant or a friend's home or something else, and it was not kosher, they ate not kosher. She said, you know, the joke says, at least their dishes will get to heaven. But that's how it was. They were kosher in the house, but not outside the house. This young woman said to me, I have a different problem. With me, it's the opposite. I now believe in kashrut, and I keep kosher. She went to the United Nations High School, and she would bring her own sandwiches to make sure that she could eat kosher. But in the house, with my parents, I have no choice. So I'm not kosher in the house. My parents have said that they would make the house kosher on the condition that the dishes, that their special dishes, their special glazed shiny dishes that are very expensive, would be able to become kosherized as well. And according to the usually accepted Jewish law, you cannot kosherize shiny dishes. That you cannot kosherize earthenware dishes. Because everything is absorbed, and that which is absorbed does not readily come out with earthenware. So this was the dilemma she gave to me. I was just beginning to study for the rabbi. My teacher was Rabbi Soloveitchik. I went to ask him the question. Rabbi Soloveitchik said to me, you can kosherize the dishes. He said, it's true that most of the authorities claim that earthenware, and therefore china, cannot be kosherized. However, this is glazed, so that makes a difference. And there are minority authorities, but there are authorities that say it's okay. You can kosherize glazed china. Second of all, there are also some authorities who say that if you put the china dishes in boiling water 3 times, you can even kosherize earthenware. In this particular instance, because after all, you do not want necessarily to eat out of those china dishes, but you have no choice because you're living in your parents' home. And because it's also important for parents and children to respect each other and get along with each other, you may certainly kosherize the dishes 3 times. With detergent, the glazed china, that's fine. Most difficult problems that I receive in Jewish law is very similar to this case. In other words, very rarely is there only one opinion on an issue. A lot of disagreement. So you can always find a place to hang your hat on if it's important. And what might be correct in one instance, according to that opinion, may not be correct in another instance, according to another opinion. Because it's not only the question, it's also the questioner. Clearly, it was important in this case to find a way that the daughter could eat in her parents' home, from her parents' cooking. I would call this the glory of Jewish pluralism. The importance of there being many different views brought to the table. And what Rav Cook said exactly this. True Torah scholars understand that there are many truths, and that all of those many truths must be brought together in order to ultimately bring peace. And it's a magnificent idea that in our generation today, especially, all you have to do is watch television a little bit, read the newspapers a little bit. When I went to university, universities prided themselves on bringing many, many different views to every issue and to opening up the minds of all the students. Nowadays, most universities, at least those in the headlines, have one view and one view only, and do not allow speakers with a different view. That's the antithesis of what Judaism is all about. And that's the antithesis of how to make peace. Making peace means bringing all the different views together and orchestrating them, depending upon the question and the questioner, which is at hand. Did I make myself clear? So, the first thing I would say, there are many different ways of interpreting every aspect of Jewish life. And it's very important not to be completely monolithic and one-sided, but to try to understand the other ways and to respect the other ways. If I were to tell you what I really believe is the underlying truth within Judaism, I would call it moral absolutism and cultural pluralism, or ritual pluralism. Judaism believes that when it comes to ethics and morality, they're very clearly absolutes. Thou shalt not murder, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not cheat, etc. When it comes to cultural truth, and even ritual truths, it's legitimate for different religions to pray differently. It's legitimate for different ritual groups within one religion also to pray differently. If I were to put it as succinctly as I can put it, I don't believe, and I believe very strongly, in halachic Judaism and in Orthodox Judaism. But I don't believe that anyone should be forced to pray the way Orthodox Jews pray. Similarly, I don't believe that non-Orthodox Jews who believe in egalitarian prayer should force everyone to be egalitarian. If they don't want to be, they don't have to be. But, and this will also show you, there's something very interesting about all of this. Because although I would not myself pray in an egalitarian prayer service, if I were course, I could certainly go. But if I were praying my prayer, I couldn't pray in such a service. However, I certainly believe that people have the right to decide differently and pray differently, and that all of Israel and the shrines in Israel dare not be for the Orthodox alone. And there must be an opportunity within a place as holy as the Kotel, as the western wall of the Holy Temple. There must be a place for those who prefer egalitarian prayer to have a possibility of egalitarian prayer. And that's why I believe that the Prime Minister made a terrible mistake by reneging on his word. And I said so. And that's why I believe that in the not very distant future, you will find that the egalitarian prayer will become official. I really believe that. There should be at least one place where that becomes possible. Clear? So that was the first issue that I had with the chief rabbi. And sometimes when they bring up other things, my name is mentioned, they say, what can we expect of Riskin? He thinks that the conservative and reform are his partners. But I'm very proud to think that. And in a meeting with the chief rabbis, I explained my position very clearly to them. I said, what you do not understand, because you've never spoken to a reform or conservative Jew, and because you never tried to find out what was behind what they do and why they do it. What you don't understand is that the conservative and reform Jew rabbis and educators are trying to make Jews more committed Jews, not less committed Jews. That's where we're partners. I live my life trying to make Jews more committed Jews. And I truly believe that conservative and reform rabbis likewise are living their lives trying to make Jews more committed Jews. We both want the same thing. We both have the same exact goals. Now, I don't agree that they go far enough. I believe that when, as they teach Judaism and try to make their Jews more committed Jews, they miss certain aspects that I think are very important. But that's okay. They certainly teach many aspects of Judaism that I also think are very important. And as long as they're bringing people closer, they are my partners. In my experience in life, partners very often disagree. In fact, they disagree very more often than they agree. What makes them partners is that they're both in the same business. And since we're both trying to make Jews more committed Jews, we're both in the same business, even though we may disagree in the details about how to do it. Clear? The second point that I'll touch on very briefly is the issue of conversion. And it seems to me that next to pluralism, within a relationship. The most important issue facing Judaism today is the issue of conversion. And let me explain. According to the Pew Reports, PEW, 71.2% of the Jews in the United States are intermarried. Generally without any real kind of Jewish education to make them become more observant Jews. 71.2% of 90%. The other 10%, that's not counting, are the Orthodox Jews who are not intermarried yet. But that means that 7/9 of the Jews are intermarried. And the next statistic that's more frightening than any of the others is that 90% of the children of those who intermarry, unless there was a strong conversion course, usually there's not. 90% of those children no longer consider themselves even to be of Jewish descent. Now, during the Holocaust, with all of Hitler's machinery, Yimach Shemo v'Zichro, may his name be blotted out, all of his machinery only succeeded in destroying 1/3. Now we're talking about the destruction of 7/9 of the Jewish people, and we're doing it to ourselves. That's what's frightening about the statistic. I, however, believe that conversion courses that are being given must be seen not, God forbid, as a tragedy, but as a tremendous opportunity. If the conversion courses are done properly and lovingly and embracingly and intelligently, we can get 2 for the price of 1. Not only bring back the Jewish part, but most often I found in my experience, the Gentile part brings back the Jewish part even more strongly. Now what first may look like a tragedy can be a tremendous opportunity. And therefore, we are establishing in Orthodox conversion centers all over the world with a special course called The Romance of Judaism, because I believe Judaism is a romance, a very loving and very happy romance between the Jewish people and the world, between the Jewish people and God. And the results can be truly, truly wonderful. Now, what's my argument with the chief rabbinate along these lines? And this might interest you, especially. You know, Soviet Jewry was mentioned in the introduction. One of the things I was very active in the beginning of my rabbinical career was Soviet Jewry and the fight of Soviet Jewry to be freed from the Iron Curtain. Let them live as Jews in the Soviet Union, the USSR, at least allow them to leave as Jews and come to Israel. That was the motto of our rebellion against the Iron Curtain. And by the way, early, this was a back and forth in the early 60s and 70s. In the beginning, there were sometimes 15 or 20 people at rallies. By the end, there were 500,000 people at rallies. And we succeeded. We truly, truly succeeded. There have been a number of documents written that the breakdown of the Soviet Union, the Iron Curtain, and the Soviet Union began the first time they realized that there was a chink in the armor of the Iron Curtain was with the Soviet Jewry demonstrations. We really did succeed. So that was a very, very important experience. Let me tell you something very interesting. Perestroika, in the early 1990s, was the term used for the opening of the Iron Gates, and the Jews were allowed to leave the Soviet Union for the first time in many, many decades. And there were approximately 1,300,000 Jews living in the Soviet Union who left the Soviet Union. Of the 1,300,000, 300,000 of them were paternally Jews, but not maternally Jews. Conventional wisdom has it, and it seems very clear from Halakha, from Jewish law, that the religion of the child follows the religion of the mother. If the mother is Jewish, the child is Jewish. If the mother is not Jewish, the child is not. The reason I think is a very clear one. First of all, you usually know who the mother is, you don't always know who the father is. So it's maternal. And second of all, the fetus is inextricably bound up with the body of the mother. And therefore it's also logical that the mother determines the religion of the child. Jewish law, however, let me begin by saying, because of the conventional wisdom that I've just mentioned, the Jews from behind the Iron Curtain were accepted with open arms in Israel. But the rabbi refused to accept with open arms those who were only internally not maternally Jewish. To such an extent that Rabbi David Lau, who was one of the two chief rabbis of Israel, actually wrote an article about a year and a quarter ago in Haaretz, a daily Israeli newspaper, saying all of those who came to Israel and are only paternally and not maternally Jewish should go back. And many of them have been persecuted. And they went through the persecutions. Now, I want to add one thing, and think back to what I said earlier. I love the Talmud, and I love Halacha Jewish law, because it always has so many different opinions. here, there are very great religio-legal experts. One of the greatest is known as the Amar of Moshe Esselis, who lived in the 16th century. Another was Rav Moshe Bar Goliot, who is the major commentary on the Jerusalem Talmud. Both of these great religious decisors say, yes, it's true. That the mother decides the religion of the child, and if the child is not born to a Jewish mother, the child must undergo conversion. However, they both say, that does not mean that the child is considered to be a Gentile. After all, the father isn't chopped liver. The father bestows DNA on the child. The father's genes is within the child. And therefore, not only these two great decisors, but many, many others, have a separate category called Zera Yisrael, those born from the seed which is Jewish. And yes, they require formal conversion, which means circumcision and ritual immersion. For man. But that's all they require. And embrace them completely. And bring them in because they're already partially in due to the paternal descent. And ask the minimum of questions and the maximum. Times in the Bible that you must love the convert. And certainly if you have so much material which says that you must act with such embrace with people who are paternally Jewish. You know, it was very interesting. The problem began because in Israel, there is what's known as the right of return. 6 million Jews were murdered in the Nazi Holocaust. Mostly because the Jews did not have safe haven. No other country would let them in. Not even America. Not even President Roosevelt, whom my grandmother used to call President Rosenfeld. He's such a fine man, he must be Jewish, President Rosenfeld. It's not true. He was an anti-Semite. He didn't even bring in the quota. Let the quota in. Anybody who comes to Israel is automatically let in, as long as he's Jewish. Now the big question, who is a Jew? So they answered that question, the Knesset did. I think, considering the situation in a brilliant fashion, they said, anyone who was Jew enough to have been sent to Auschwitz, which meant if he had one Jewish grandparent, he was sent to Auschwitz. So anyone who was Jew enough to have one Jewish grandparent has to be Jew enough to be welcomed into Israel with the right of return and Israeli citizenship. I think, given the historical situation, it was a brilliant, brilliant solution. Now came the problem. There are 350,000 paternal descent from the Soviet Union. And the chief rabbis did not decide according to the law of return. And they didn't decide according to the rabbis I mentioned earlier. And instead they said, let them go back to Russia. They're not Jewish. This is where I argue mightily against the chief rabbi. With all the halachic material that I had, they wanted to close my conversion court. I started a conversion court. We've converted many hundreds of converts with a great deal of embrace, and especially all of them with a great deal of embrace, and with very few questions, those who were at least paternally Jewish. The Supreme Court set in, and the Supreme Court said, ruled in my favor, that I'm an Orthodox rabbi of a city in Israel, and I have every right to establish my own conversion court. And now, there are four such conversion courts throughout Israel. We are converting thousands of Jews. And we've sidestepped the rabbinate very nicely. And it seems to me that if there is to be viable religion within Israel, it must be pluralistic. It must be understanding. And it must be sensitive to human problems. I thank you for your patience. If there are questions, disagreements, I will gladly try to take them up.
Thank you very much.
Rabbi Riskin, has the chief rabbinate changed its policy of not recognizing most of the Orthodox rabbis' conversions here in America?
I really cannot speak for the chief rabbis, and neither do I wish to. I don't know that they've changed their policy. I really don't. But I do know one thing. Let's take my case. They certainly will not yet accept despite the Supreme Court, they will not yet accept my conclusions. However, the largest Orthodox rabbinical organization in Israel is Rabbanei Zohar. They have about 680 rabbinic members. And just about all the rabbis of Rabbanei Zohar will accept my conversions. I will marry them. So that what we have succeeded in doing is sidestepping the chief rabbi. It doesn't matter anymore whether they accept it or not. Because the overwhelming majority of the populace in Israel, the rabbinic populace in Israel, does accept it.
What about for purposes of marriage?
The same thing. I have the right to marry, and many, many rabbis in Rabbanit Zohar have the right to marry. So I have the right to marry them.
No, which is right. Okay. And there's, so I don't want to dominate it. By extension, what about the Masorti conversions?
So here, that's an interesting, that you asked the $54,000 question that I accepted, that I expected. I can't promise that you're going to like my answer, but I'm going to tell you my answer. First of all, no, the Masorti conversions are not accepted. Let me repeat what I said before. I certainly believe that Masorti congregations have to have a place to pray in the Kotel, even though I don't agree with that. As far as something like conversion is concerned, I do believe I would like to see every Jew be able to marry every other Jew. And from my perspective, I think, speaking within Israel as well, I think that the official halacha of Israel should be Orthodox. Not Haredi, not ultra-Orthodox. But she's being Orthodox. And I'll tell you why. Number one, because everyone accepts an Orthodox conversion, almost everyone. I mean, you always have people who know that. But the overwhelming majority accepts an Orthodox conversion. Number one. Number two, because the overwhelming majority of religious Israel is Orthodox. And the numbers of conservative and reform are very small, to such an extent that, and hear me very well, the synagogue that the secular Jew in Israel does not go to is an Orthodox synagogue. Because the rare times that he will go for a bar mitzvah or a bat mitzvah, he prefers an Orthodox Jew. I want you to understand, over 65% of Israel is Sephardi, not Ashkenazi. And the Sephardi are very, very traditional. The overwhelming majority of cases, they will not pray in the synagogue, which is mixed. So I think, even in terms of numbers, and especially because I would like in Israel everyone to be able to marry everyone else, I would urge Orthodox conversions. But I don't think you agree.
No, but I'm not going to But one of the nice things, one of the beautiful parts of Judaism, what attracted me to Judaism, peace, my rabbinate, are the words of the ancient rabbis who taught, Elu ve'elu divrei Elohim Chaim. Your words, my words, are all words of the same living God. And God willing, we'll all come to a common understanding here one day, but until then we'll agree to disagree, but disagree with respect for each other.
And I still respect you very, very much, but I want to disagree with what you just said with this.
wouldn't be Jewish if you did.
When they said it was Beit Hillel and Beit Shammai who were both within a halachic structure. That's very important. I was involved several decades ago in a possibility in Denver in trying to find one way of converting that everyone could agree, minimally, would be okay, in order to unite all of the conversions. It failed because the Reform rabbi refused to say that circumcision was a necessary part of conversion. You see, once you open it up to the different divisions, it's not under the halachic structure. Those Beit Hillel and Beit Shammai were two different views, especially about conversion, they argue. But they each could bring halacha to their side. That wouldn't be the case if we're talking about all the branches. And that's one of the problems.
Are there... No, I agree. I'm going to give others. There's other questions here, I think. Yes. I'd love to continue this.
Rabbi, you touched on the
issue. You're a gentleman, not only a rabbi, but a gentleman in the scholar, yes.
You touched on the issue of patrilineal descent and regarded the import of the role that a Jewish father plays. When you read the Torah, not a single one of our patriarchs married a Jewish woman. Moshe didn't marry a Jewish woman. I can't find anywhere where anyone in the Torah married a Jewish woman. In fact, when we bless our children on Shabbos, and we bless the boys, Yisimcha, Elohim, Kefran, Menashe, I don't think either of them married a Jewish woman, and Yisimcha, Elohim, Kesarar, of Karachel, Leah, none of them were born Jewish. Given what we know in the Torah, why is patrilineal descent not recognized as Jewish?
Yes, you're right. Except. First of all, I think you know very well, I spoke about halachic structure. We don't learn halachic structure from the Bible. We learn from the Talmud. The commentaries in the Bible would say that they did convert. That it's obvious they converted. You know, the joke they had that says, how do you know that Abraham wore a kippah? One Jew asks him that. The other Jew says, I don't know. Maybe he didn't. He says, of course he did. When Abraham had walked out, it says, you know, that Abraham walked out. When Abraham had walked out to any place without a kippah, of course he wore. That's what the rabbis of the Midrash say about the conversions. The one thing I can tell you, which is biblical and strongly biblical, you'll remember according to the book of Ezra, I think it's chapter 10, when the Jewish men were taking Gentile women as their wives, Ezra forced all the Gentile wives to leave. With their children. In other words, according to the book of Ezra, the children of Jewish husbands and Gentile wives were Gentile. That seems pretty clear. But be that as it may, the halacha is very clear. Child follows the religion of the mother. But nevertheless, as I mentioned, the rabbis, harks back to the first thing I said this evening, the rabbis were very sensitive. And they always found ways, and they do give paternal descent its due. in the sense that it's just a formal conversion and nothing else. And it's very easy.
I realize that there's no short answer to this question, but I just crossed my mind that since you live on the other side of the Green Line, do you see any hope for any kind of peace moving forward with the Palestinian issue?
First of all, I don't understand the Green Line. I live in Judea and Samaria. So that, that I think that's very important. I mean what I said. I mean, I live in Judea and Samaria. Having said that, we have wonderful relations with the Palestinian villages. I fought for their right to have extra land, and they received it. I believe they want peace as much as I want peace. And I think they deserve all the rights that the Israelis have living in Israel. And certainly, I believe with all my heart, I'm a settler, a proud settler. The Hebrew word for settler is a bit nachel, which means an inheritor. I inherited my ancestral land, and I'm returning to that ancestral land. However, every inch of the land of the Frat was gone over with a fine tooth comb, and each time we build more. Before we start to build, we announce that we're building in this parcel of land, and if anyone can prove that they have any kind of claim to that land, please step forward. And the only land that we built on, that's true of most of the settlements, is what was no man's land. If there's any Palestinian living anywhere, it's forbidden for any Jew to live there and take it away from it. Whatever it is, even if it's in Jerusalem, that's Jewish law, and very, very clear. I would love to see a two-state solution. But I tell you, that would be an impossibility unless the other side ready to state something very simple, which I think we have always stated, we're all ready to state. We recognize the right of the Palestinians to live in the land which is called Israel-Palestine. What we have to do is negotiate boundaries, but we believe in their right to be where they are, and we expect them to believe in our right to be where we are. They have never said that. And as long as they have never said that, I can't accept a two-state solution with another state that wants to destroy me. I think I have no right to be. And that's the real problem facing us today.
So this is a follow-up to what was just discussed. You said something very interesting, and that is you believe that the Palestinians in Yehuda Shomron should have the same rights as Israelis. I think that's what you said.
That's what I said. That's what I mean.
Okay. So that this battle between is the future of Israel to be a democratic country or a Jewish country? You believe it can be both? And that would mean that Arabs have the right to vote, those who live in Yehuda Shomron?
Now, let me say again, Judaism believes in democracy in the world of Yisrael. Any Arab who lives in Judea and Samaria under Jewish rule, that's not the case now. But any Arab who would live in Judea and Samaria under Jewish rule must have the right to vote from our perspective. Must.
Well, if Yehuda Shimon was to be brought into Israel, then you will have an Arab population that is as large as the Jewish population.
Who said I believe that should happen right now? I don't. I'm not ready to do that. And many other people like me are not ready to do that. Because I want Israel to be made a Jewish state, and I don't think we can control Arabs in the Jewish state who don't have the right to.
Again, I want to take the opportunity to personally thank Rabbi Riskin for joining us here, and thank Harvey Knapper for this meeting.
I want to remind you of something. Just 2 weeks ago, God promised Hebron to the Jewish people. God said to Abraham, all this land that you're walking on belongs to you. Sarah dies. Abraham has to find a burial place. Abraham doesn't say, God gave me the land, I want this land to bury my wife. He ends up paying 400 pieces of silver for the land. There is no compromise. You can't go over to a Palestinian who's living in a piece of land that he has the right to live on because he has proof that it was his ancestors' land. You can't go over to him and take away his land. The halacha calls it gezelachmi. You can't steal from someone else. God says eventually we'll have the land. As I said, certainly in Ephrat, but in most of Judea and Samaria, we build on no man's land. But that's very, very important, and I believe in this as part of Jewish law. Thank you very much.